children's programming was on thin ice, and so was the head of programming at CBS, Fred Silverman. Silverman's latest pitch, a show about teenagers and their dogs solving mysteries, got shot down. Parents had dubbed superhero cartoons and kids shows alike too violent, and networks needed to create a new show to combat the growing outrage. This pitch would have been a solution to the problem, but now he needed to start over. As Silverman tried to sleep on a flight to LA, he struggled coming up with a different idea. However, as the plane landed, Frank Sinatra's voice came onto the PA system. As Silverman became lost in the music, it finally clicked.
For strangers in the night. Doo-dee-doo-bee-doo. Doo-doo-doo-dee-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da.
These are lyrics from Strangers in the Night, a song by Frank Sinatra. You may not have ever heard of the name or the song before, but his music took the United States by storm from the 1940s to the 1960s. Even today, he's still considered one of the world's best-selling artists of all time. This was it. Silverman's new show would be called Scooby-Doo. But it wasn't just his show. Two other men are also responsible for Scooby-Doo's creation, but their part in the creation process hasn't been acknowledged nearly enough. I think it's about time we discuss the rest of the culprits behind the show and discover the true mystery behind the production of Scooby-Doo.
Where are you? We got some work to do now. Scooby-Dooby-Doo, where are you? We need some help from you now. Come on, Scooby-Doo.
Worries over children's programming peaked in the 1960s. The assassinations of John F. Kennedy, Martin Luther King Jr., and Robert F. Kennedy threw the public into a great state of unrest. On top of all this, violence appeared to be on the rise in high schools and college settings. All of these factors are suspected to have been the cause for such concerns over the cartoons airing at the time. Many cartoons airing included action adventures such as The Adventures of Batman, Spider-Man, Johnny Quest, Space Ghost, and a lot more. As public outcry grew over the violence in cartoons, some networks began turning to developing new cartoons to appease the protests of concerned parent groups. The Archie Show was one of the many products of these protests. Based off the Archie comics that became popularized in the 1940s, the show followed the crazy misadventures of Archie Andrew and his friends. It wasn't just your typical animated show. Not only did it seemingly weed out the violence many parents stressed over, but it included a lot of dancing and musical segments going along with popular music at the time. The Archie Show would debut on CBS in 1968, becoming an immediate hit shortly after. Having struck gold on The Archie Show, CBS was looking to cash in on more animated projects with the same vibe. Silverman had a particular idea in mind that fit the bill, a show about kids going to haunted houses. He felt it was an untapped market that could be a pretty big hit. Thus, he put Hanna-Barbera Studios to the task, a small but up-and-coming animation studio credited for then-popular shows such as The Flintstones, The Jetsons, and many others. It would be writers Joe Ruby and Ken Spears that developed Silverman's vision further. Ruby had drawn cartoons since high school, and after his service in the Navy and Marines, he started off at Disney, then left to work for Hanna-Barbera Studios. Spears found himself at the studios also after serving in the Navy, having been offered a job there by none other than one of the co-founders of the studio, William Hanna, who just so happened to be a friend's father. Hello? It was at the studio where Ruby and Spears would meet in the editing room, becoming an inseparable pair. The two have been described as network darlings by another writer, and apparently even favorites of Silverman himself. I mean, who better else to assign the job to? The pair were given specific directions. The show should be a mix between a radio show called I Love a Mystery and a horror comedy movie Abbott and Costello Meet Frankenstein. The characters should be based off of those in the sitcom The Many Loves of Dobby Gillis. There should also be a pop song in every episode too, just like the Archie show, and the show should not, by any means, include any violence. So, the duo got to work. The original pitch was dubbed The Mysteries Five. Teenagers Jeff, Mike, Kelly, Linda, her brother WW, and their dog Too Much were all in a band called, well, The Mysteries Five. Too Much played the bongos, and the teens traveled the country playing gigs, all the while solving mysteries along the way, which involved real monsters instead of humans in disguise. The pitch came together nicely, but it wasn't without complications. One noticeable issue was the dog itself. The Archie show already involved a dog, so they needed to be mindful their own design didn't look too much like him. I forgot I wrote that in there. I can't entirely take all the credit for that. One of the sources I cited for this video and made a pretty similar pun. Joseph Barbera, the other co-founder of Hanna-Barbera Studios, suggested making the dog a Great Dane instead, though that could have also risked making the character to look too similar to Marmaduke's design, another Great Dane from a comic strip. It would be Iwo Takamoto, another artist at the studio, that would solve the problem. After consulting a fellow employee that just so happened to breed Great Danes, he took everything she said and drew the complete opposite. Not only was Takamoto's design completely different from any other cartoon dog that Too Much could have been confused for, but the design was silly. It was the perfect fit for the show. Finally, they had their big pitch. Except, we all know that this isn't where the story ends. The show was just too frightening, according to the CBS president at the time. The pitch would be turned down, and Ruby and Spears would have to return back to the drawing board. But it wasn't all terrible. In fact, the concept would be revised in the matter of a couple hours. Jeff and Mike were combined into the character Fred, who was originally named Ronnie, but Silverman requested he be renamed to Fred. You gotta wonder why. Kelly turned into Daphne, Linda turned to Velma, and WW to Shaggy. The tone would shift from fearful to comedic, shifting Shaggy and Scooby to the spotlight in the process, and the band idea would be scrapped entirely. The title of the new show would be changed to Who's Scared instead. Yeah, that's certainly a name. But it would later be revised to Scooby-Doo, Where Are You? And of course, as mentioned in the beginning of this video, Scooby-Doo's name came from Strangers of the Night. Except, I might have just lied to you earlier. While Silverman, Spears, and Ruby would claim it did, one writer for Scooby-Doo teleplays and comic book strips claims it was actually from a song called Denise by a band dubbed Randy and the Rainbows. It's hard to say where Scooby-Doo's name came from, just with the varying accounts on the matter, so it's perhaps the case that the true origins may just be lost to time and up to interpretation. All I'll say is that I love Frank Sinatra, but that S in the Denise really seeps into the Doobie-Doo. Yeah. But regardless, Scooby-Doo was a hit. The show would be met with instant success, just as CBS had hoped it would be. The original show would only run for about a year, but it would inspire various ripoffs, which could be a whole video in itself, and a long-running franchise that has somehow managed to survive to this day. Scooby-Doo, as a franchise, even beat The Simpsons in achieving a Guinness World Record of most prolific cartoon in 2004. I mean, that's sort of impressive. I'm certain nobody working on the original show expected Scooby-Doo to become just as popular as it did, but somehow, despite all odds, it's still kicking. Some people might say the franchise should have probably died out a long time ago, but if you ask me, I kind of find the show quite wholesome. It's changed in many ways over the years, but it's just a nice, simple watch sometimes. I remember watching the multitude of movies that would air on Cartoon Network back when I was a kid, and they were always just very fun. I have a bit of a soft spot for Scooby-Doo, and I wouldn't be surprised if many people did either. Clearly, the franchise did something right if it has lasted this long. And honestly, I kind of hope it keeps kicking. It might not be the most amazing piece of media ever out there. I am not trying to say that. But it's just fun and kind of cute. And I don't think its cultural impact can go unnoticed either. Costumes involving the Scooby-Doo characters are probably more or less one of the more popular options for Halloween. Now, I'm not going to say my next statement under the lens of kids experiencing non-violent shows, whatever that means. I mean, if anyone watching has seen some of the newer Scooby-Doo properties out there, you would know that the series has not exactly stuck to that whole non-violent idea. But I'd honestly love to see kids in the future also grow up experiencing Scooby-Doo, whichever form the franchise takes. Except for Velma, but, you know, a lot of people have critiqued that already.
Excuse me?
However, before closing this video, I think it's important we acknowledge all creators of this cartoon. Silverman absolutely was a part of the development of the show, but as I dug into this topic, it honestly seems as if Spears and Ruby haven't received nearly as much credit for their work. Back in the day, writers and artists weren't promoted very much. In fact, the credit for many shows didn't go to specific people, but the studios or studio heads they worked under. So while Hanna-Barbera Studios may have been credited with making the show every time the intro to Scooby-Doo played, Ruby and Spears' names would never come up. It's very unfortunate to hear, especially as an artist myself. And I could not imagine creating a show, watching it grow this popular, and not even seeing my name attached. To see that someone else is getting complete credit for the things that you created, you know, any artist would know that it hurts. From what I've read, Ruby and Spears' skills had taken them a variety of places in the industry, from CBS, ABC, to eventually their own animation company, Ruby Spears Productions. Mark Evanier, a writer who once worked for them both, couldn't have said it any better. Ken and Joe left behind hundreds of hours of cartoons that will rerun forever, featuring characters they created that were an important part of millions of childhoods. Over the course of their careers, they were inseparable friends, making each other laugh not only in the animation studio, but also in each other's backyards. One of Spears' sons once asked if his dad ever wanted another partner, to which his dad, Spears, raised a question in response. Why would I ever want to work with anybody else but Joe? Ken Spears and Joe Ruby have left behind a huge legacy in the entertainment industry. And I hope this video spreads both of their names just a little bit further. Thank you both, and rest in peace. Thank you all for watching, and I'll maybe see you next time. Your eyes are filled with stars.